the world graphical.
I add value through my products.
I am an animator.
I am a filmmaker. I develop trends.
I transform designs to reality.
I create environments.
I translate stories to furniture.
I design experiences.
I'm an immersive media designer.
I design mobility.
This is not only a design institute.
This is a design lab.
Join us in our design movement.
Welcome to the 9th edition of MITID webinar series. I am Professor Matthew Kurian, HOD of Graphic Design at MIT Institute of Design. In this edition of webinar, we are going to discuss about the graphic in design with an industry and academic expert, Professor Ranjana Dani. Also, we will address to the questions of our live audience through a small Q&A session. The topics in this session would be about the word graphic design. Who is a graphic designer? What does he do? What is he actually also evolving to be? The future of what we are looking at. Ranjana, what is happening in design education?
So, hi Matthew.
Hi.
Typically, as we must know, design makes continuous demands from every breed of young professionals. So, in design school, we typically try to aim at creating an environment where we could challenge students to craft unpredictable solutions, intense in its sensitivity, experimental in its concept and the crafting, as also well validated in the outcome. So the buzzword is a round of unending exploration. So typically at any design school in a class of say 40, we might see a minimum of say 100 concepts evolving, going up to an equal number of visual vocabulary sort of outputs. These, when they integrate into a collateral, we see so many options as design solutions. And I think that's really the whole challenge to goad students on and to inspire them to build. So this very intricate rapport that the mentor and the mentee has,
yeah.
You know, and as also the way in which peers learn from each other. I think that's what builds a really happy and healthy design environment.
How is it different from general colleges? In a sense, when you see it in films and when you see it in different contexts, you just generally see colleges being a professor coming in with large number of students, professor giving a lecture, people taking in notes and some interaction. But what do you think, what is this general thing about design education that is totally outrightly different from what has been generally been, you know, is there?
So I think it is necessary to follow a structured format. It is necessary for faculty to bring in structured content to a class, an established abstract. Maybe there needs to be a system of how a project will proceed in terms of its process. However, when the best part, the fun part really is when the creatives or the creative thinking really comes in. So in that whole space of design thinking, starting with say strategy, that could be creative in the way that it evolves, right up to the outcome, to whether a certain color works or not, you know.
No, but is it classroom?
It is.
Is it a classroom?
It is still the classroom and it is still possibly the four walls. However, I think the students have transported into a realm or zone of their own, because it's not really where they sit and how they must work and watch a blackboard and take down notes. It's typically into small little self studios, and hence it would not be wrong to say that our classrooms are called studios, you know. As also you know, we've tried more and more to move students out of this typical academic bubble as such, you know, and there are lots of visits that happen. There are lots of interesting experts that peep in for a review of latest work.
Yeah.
Also sharing stories from where they have sort of come out with innovative work yeah. themselves.
Who are these faculty? Can you just explain? When it comes to faculties, they are also quite different. They are not like the general professors.
I think I'd like to throw that question back at you. So
okay.
you're from the industry.
Yeah.
And I have been in academics for the longest time. It's possibly been 35 years now, and I have been an academician, as they say.
Yeah.
And you've come from the industry, and you're sharing your invaluable experience with us. So maybe you can tell us what it feels like in the last 2 years that you've been here.
Yeah. Have you? So it's been like 3 years now. In March I'll turn three. So I'm very small to three versus three decades of experience. I was also making an equation here that you must have at least trained 6,000 designers in 30 years in an average of 200, interacting with 200 students. In a way, yeah, because whenever I meet, I know that they know people, and that is how the fraternity is. It's very close.
It is.
So even when I was as a professional in design, we know. So when I came to here, I know that Mahinder Bhai is here. You are here, and we've been told by our peers in the industry, you're going to teach. The gods are there. They are going to teach you. You know, that's how we regard our. Fellow seniors.
I think it's beautiful to think like that, but I guess I've seen such brilliant work coming out of youngsters, and I think they are so much more our teachers than we really being the teachers.
Yeah.
So I think the word really here is not a teacher and a student.
Yeah,
it's so much the mentor-mentee that I started out with, and then the learner, because I think at least at the senior level, they are almost like learning by themselves.
Yeah.
And that is really the good part of an open environment like this.
Yeah.
So there is a classroom, there are four walls, there is a structure, there is a system, and yet they have the freedom to really, open up and almost fly.
Yeah.
You know,
as when you ask me why I came here to teach, is basically even I think the working designers, they're constantly learning. And I think it's one of the fields where you want to go out and give it out back to the community. As to what you've learned, and everyone learns in a very different fashion. So even my experience, my journey as a designer has not been very, very typical career based.
So
I started off by I did my applied arts, then I did museology, which is a museum science course.
Yeah.
Then wanted to do PhD, but I had to drop out because of work. Then did photo researching, which was very interesting for like 3-4 years. Then I joined Penguin, did a lot of editorial design. And it just changed, so it's also adaptability. So whatever you want to do, you keep doing it using a scenario. So
also, Matthew, is it not true that when in design, when we're teaching here, for example, say a course in packaging, we do integrate with so many other disciplines,
Absolutely.
I mean, we're trying that really hard as to how the students, when they move from here into industry and would work in a multidisciplinary environment, is that the kind that we can established here, and I think that's the way the world works, right? So I think that is a very, very important need of the hour. It's possibly a growing trend also in the way that walls are blurring between disciplines,
and absolutely.
Faculty from every discipline is coming in to share an input.
I think at the end of the day, what is actually going to be in the future is it's only going to be design. This class of being graphic designer, product designer, film designer, animation designer, it'll all actually merge.
Absolutely.
A person who is doing BDIS fashion is now suddenly turned into a product designer, and vice versa. A product designer has become a textile designer, and then further becomes a graphic designer. Is certainly making a set somewhere, who's got into film. So at the end of the day, we kind of experience the entire system.
I think the word is experience. So there are a lot of these claims where at least today, everybody claims to be a graphic designer. Everybody claims to be a graphic designer. And then there is this 4-year course that we run, and another 2 years of the master's. And then there are learners from other disciplines. They say, we can design a logo. So how does that really work in terms of when they come out into the industry and they sort of, seek for, say, projects that may not be within the discipline of their learning, but maybe something more or else like you're talking about?
I think when you go into the industry, even the subcontinent, the Southeast Asia continent, this part of this world, is still very, is kind of not gone out from its territories. It is in that the Central Europe and the American part where they are still considering design because they lived in design.
Absolutely.
They don't have that segregation in their head. It's purely design. You're a designer, that's it. That's the end of this thing. So, but I think we are there in the future, and what I'm seeing in the last 5 years and what is happening is that everybody is now understanding design. They understand why a brand identity has to be made from a person who understands brand identity rather than just using a software to make a logo. It's no more a logo. We don't call it logo. We call it branding. We call it much, we put it in a higher, you know, pedestal.
So again, that word experience, you know,
creating experience,
design experiences is the...
You know, my experience in Classmate, when I was the designer for Classmate, we used to work with, everything used to come to me, pencils used to come to me, the geometry box used to come to me, the Classmate notebooks used to be there. So at the end of the day, it was purely experience, making that and solving a specific problem in the market and executing it is what it's all about.
So it's pretty much the same here, though individuals craft and create their own output. We know there are juries that need to be conducted, but I think it makes the students so much smarter because it lets them take the onus of the whole project onto themselves and really, feel the pride in what they have crafted from the onset to an output.
Yeah.
And I think these are things that give them that confidence that is needed to get out into the industry and do something almost single-handed.
I'm thinking of the students who are actually looking it from what do they want to do and the kind of confusions that they have, especially when they have, you know, like confusion like where do I go, what do I do, do I do fine arts, what is this visual communication, what is graphic design,
That's right. Does
it, is there a hierarchy of a bigger umbrella, is it visual communication is a bigger umbrella and you have fine arts, visual communication, applied art, you know, all kinds of things that is in different nomenclature maybe. Whether it's overlapping, whether it's not overlapping, what are the differences?
So typically, since both of us are from the same background at Applied Art, it was always about art applied for a context. So essentially, the buzzword was advertising, and we advertised for products and services, pretty much similar to what graphic designers in design schools do.
Yeah.
However, the whole approach is slightly different. We're not looking at target audiences as consumers, we're possibly looking at target audiences as users. Hence, a slightly more sensitive approach, getting into the depth of things, getting into creating long-lasting solutions than just quick, you know, gimmicky outputs that might be sold well as a product or a service through the advertising that is also done to quickly work as such, you know. But I think if you have to go back to the word graphics as a term, the word graphene actually comes from easy to reproduce.
Okay.
So in the yesteryears, so much was not done like it was today in terms of print and production.
Yeah.
So it was really difficult to produce stuff which might have a very difficult artwork per se. You know?
Absolutely.
So that which was simple to produce was graphics. And it has possibly stuck in terms of that part of its meaning, the simplicity, which today reflects as a solution. What is simple, what is easy to send out or grasp or connect would typically be an effective solution. And I think that is what it is. But if you go back to the terms of how you would connect it with visual communication, I think somewhere for a visual communicator, the visual language is the biggest quotient, wherein building a strong vocabulary is the challenge.
Okay.
And to build that strong vocabulary, you need form, you need color, you need shape, you need size, you need structure. And all these would possibly be those elements of tools through which a graphicist articulates himself.
Okay.
So building skills in these elements would typically be the work or the chore of a graphic designer.
Okay. So I think, so maybe
so it's restricted in its task as what the student today is called. Typically the student is the larger context, which is the communication designer. So he's communicating through graphics is one part. But is he a graphic designer? Then he would possibly be restricted to just building up those skills. And that's not how it is.
Okay. So, who is a graphic designer then?
So, in terms of course, the must-have skills and the building of that to be able to use and utilize those graphics within collaterals, within communication design solutions. Mm. And then also to be able to think strategically, to be able to think sensitively, to be able to think with social relevance, to be able to narrate the story through to an output. I think all of that really clubs with what the skill tools are, you know, and then the output kind of almost immerses from.
So you're saying you're using the word collateral. Mm-hmm. What is collateral?
When I was in graphic design school, we called them medias. So we had to sell an ad through a poster. Now today, we don't come into a class and say, okay, let's design a poster. We need to tell them that let's find a solution of how this product can be promoted. And they may select or utilize any form of a collateral within which this selling plan can be kind of
So multiple products, range of products is a collateral.
Range of platforms, not necessarily typical media. So there's so much to say with terms of new age media, and then beyond that there is so much else that has been articulated as newer media. So it's not just the typical digital or print media that is being looked at today. I mean, even the floor can be your space, and so can an intangible whiff of say a coffee be, you know, the articulation.
Okay. And what do you, so you've seen 3 decades of design technically, 4 decades of design, and you from the analog to the digital. Many of the last 2 generations have not seen the analog. Well, I mean, when I was doing my college, we used to use spray guns. Now gradient is like one nudge.
Absolutely.
And so with all this experience, where do you think it's actually going? Do you think it's going somewhere intangible? Do you think, because whatever we have right now is quite tangible. And whatever surfaces that are generally graphic design is looked to is that we are the one who makes the outer skin. But has graphic now, is no more graphic as the nomenclature? Is it purely, is like how it's been termed, the graphic in design? It could be anything in design. Is there where we are going actually?
I'm like going back into that whole phase of, when you did work by hand, and today in this whole digital mode, you know, where you are allowing so many tools to maybe modulate what you would like to process and bring forth. I think there was a phase in between when we just switched from hand done work to this digital zone. It was a magical space where everybody loved to be, you know, working with these smart tools, and software was the buzzword, and you know, everybody needed to know the best of how to use all of that to craft effectively. I think in the last 4 or 5 years, I'm seeing a good blend of the two. And there is an understanding and an awareness of why an initial hand scribble works. Or even through a process, sometimes maybe you need to go back to resort to a pencil on paper for some detailed part of a solution. So I think that little fear, you know, of keeping the hand thing or possibly throwing it out the window is not really true. People have started, students and faculty alike, people from industry do that all the time. They're working by hand. They're carrying their markers around everywhere in their studios. So I think that's a good sort of it's a sigh of relief, I think, you know, because we learnt computers when I was about 40, you know, and then post that. But when we saw the huge sort of change happening, it was scary. It was scary, but I think we've landed fairly well from that.
Okay. There's a live question here right now. Preeti is asking, what is the difference between graphic design and applied arts?
Yeah. So like I said, I think it's not really about a difference between the two. We've already explained that graphics is about essentially the elements that you would use to craft applied art. you know. And like I said earlier too, applied art is art utilized to generate, say, a design solution. So design solution in advertising, because applied art is associated with advertising focusedly, it would be to sell products and services. So when you're selling a product or service, and for that you're utilizing art, then that art or generating the artistic quotient per se, or the arts within the typography or the visual element, to be more specific, is what graphics is all about.
But we tend to go in both sides. We go become an applied artist. Applied artist can, is that something that happens?
I have really not been able to understand, in spite of being in design focusedly in the last 15 years now, why we would like to treat the advertising word as a subsidiary. It's not. I think at the end of the day, every product or every transportation piece that is crafted and created is about a brand. It needs to be crafted well so it delivers, and not just delivers, but because people will buy it to see that it gets delivered. So in that context somewhere, I think it is important to understand that the promotion of it, which typically happens not just because branding creates experiences, but branding also pushes and promotes the marketing of the same.
Okay. Sumit has a very, it's something that we are discussing right now, is about going back analog. So he's asking, do I need to be a good, do I need to be good at drawing to become a graphic designer?
You just need to be really good at drawing for anything that you do within graphic design, design per se, applied art, communication design. All of that.
I think design.
Now see, I think the question might have been asked slightly differently, so I'll just take it into another zone. There is a huge difference between drawing and illustration. And lots of people who think they can draw well might end up becoming illustrators. And hence, so if I draw well, can I become an illustrator? Becomes that big question. Drawing is a base to articulate. Illustration is the second level when information converts into communication. And hence, illustration becomes effective only if you can find it within its varied effective styles. Whereas drawing has to do with a very basic level of articulation. And that articulation needs to be effective because it is about communication, whether it is about communication between people within the industry or whether it is about showing a drawing to a certain product designer as to how a certain thing must materialize, or then providing a drawing to a vendor to show him how
it should be done.
It should be done.
What, so Nishita has a question. She's asking, what aspect of graphic design do your course cover?
I think in terms of typical graphics, we are looking broadly again at the elements of design. We are looking at typography, we are looking at illustration, we are looking at, say, yes, photography in some part, though I would possibly put that more into a technical zone. The output becomes graphic, but the doing is more sort of, you know, a technical process per se. But as far as illustration and typography is concerned, it's entirely in the graphics of how the articulation spells itself out that it might lend you know, a certain personality to a visual outcome or a visual communication.
This one, another question by Dhwani. What qualities do a successful graphic designer possess? Can I make it more profound? Can I make it like, what qualities do a good human being have? It should be as, you know, profound as that, because in the area and the fraternity of design, being good is just about how you evolve as a designer, because you can never stay in one space and be good at it. It's not being the best surgeon in the country. It's like you're constantly solving problems that has been addressed to you in different products and services.
Absolutely.
What do you think?
Absolutely, I agree with you entirely. And I think those traits that we build in each learner that go way beyond just building skills in them, possibly building better learners in terms of being good human beings or being aware and alert, possibly being really crazy and pushy to go out there and grasp and learn and unlearn and all of that, you know.
Yeah.
So I think that passion that needs to be built in anybody. So I think any good graphic designer, or any other form of designer per se, should typically be fairly passionate about how and what he does.
On just on the same tangent, how have you seen the client being different now? In a sense, they're less pushy, and how it's been like a common joke in the design fraternity is how clients can be really, really difficult and they just, you know, run you over. But do you think that things have changed now? The clients are willing to listen, they are trying to give you that freedom because they understand now it's like an expertise area where... Yeah.
I think there's definitely a huge respect for design today as a profession, as a serious sort of contribution to any business, wherein it might lend a sales push to a certain context. And innovation being the buzzword, I think, you know, design is really possibly the in thing today, if I may say that. However, coming back to the question, there have been clients of every kind. So there have been clients even then, say about 20 years back, and there are clients today who are possibly not as aware and alert, and they'd allow us to do our bit. However, the ones that are aware and alert and are yet allowing us to do our bit are definitely the kind that are not just part of this whole dialogue to generate good design, but they're also respectful of those that generate it.
Arushi is asking us, how can a graphic design degree help me making in a career in digital media? Taking from this, is design education has been always been questioned because everybody is a designer. Everybody can do TikTok, everybody can do Instagram, do filters. So what does happen in design education that makes a difference? And we make them ready for almost everything that happens in design. Do you think that's important?
See, I think you started with this whole aspect of the digital design thing. I think that's one platform, you know. I mean, I don't think just because digital design is around, you know, print is going to go anywhere. I think print is beautiful in the way it has evolved. It's become so much more experiential because it has a challenge to stand out against digital, which is already interactive in some way, you know. So I think all media take up from each other and evolve in their own beautiful way. Because at the end of the day, I don't think in any communication campaign that needs to work towards a certain common goal or aim, one media can work isolatedly by itself. They'll have to work in supportive kind of, you know.
I think it's also not online. It's not saying it's because that is categorized as online. It could be artificial intelligence, it could be also understanding, like many of our students right now, this student who I'm mentoring is working in machine learning and creating graphics based on collecting of data, analyzing it, and bringing down understanding how a city is moving, how is it changing, by just taking in data and creating a graphic out of it.
Absolutely.
So it is something that you evolve.
Absolutely.
And it is not that we make you prepare for it, but the basics and the foundation is such that your online website will look like a book, but it comes from the layouting exercise. Your user experience has been taught in how a certain personality or a person who is interacting in that sphere will interact and study the research that goes back to it. So it's not about getting ready for an online platform or any platform. It's like ready, making you ready to get into any kind of problem and you can come out solving it. There's another question by Bilal. Which design process one should consider while working with projects like poster design or any other visual design? So basically, what are the different design processes, or is it like a common formula? Do you have a formula?
So there's always been a typical formula from strategize to the output. So there's strategize, there is generate the content, typically ideate, and then deliver, you know.
Yeah.
However, I think all these four words or so many in-between words might work very contextually to each project.
Yeah.
So, if you're talking about, say, poster design, because he's asked about it, I think the more important thing over there at level one is essentially initially to have visual impact, because there can be thousands of posters on the roads and half of them may not even be seen. But we do appreciate the fact that once you go closer to a poster, you might just say, nah, I mean, that's no big deal really, you know. So, for the poster to have the intensity to get the viewer to get interested, to get involved, at level three to feel convinced and then get into the call for action.
Yeah.
I think that in the way that the process is from the end of how the consumer must see it. However, when the designer designs, he typically needs to follow just the opposite process. So he starts by understanding what is it if I do or use or this poster for, will I be able to generate a call for action?
Okay.
And then you go back to, so what do I craft here so it becomes convincing? Now, can that crafting be so boring that nobody even want to read it? So that's where possibly the creative quotient, whether it is the copy or the aesthetic or the storytelling that comes in. And possibly right at the end, it's that the look and feel or the visual impact, because which that poster on that road with 30 others should not be missed out. So, you know, if you look at a typical consumer response model, it works one way for the consumer and it works exactly.
So, you're saying there's no formulated way of working in the process of design?
I don't think there is, you know, sort of a broad formula for everything. There is a broad guideline for it. So, a process is typically a guideline. And I think it can be adapted and should be adapted in so much more detail for each project.
Okay. This question I think I want to answer. It says basically, which software are essential to learn for graphic designers? It's a very typical answer. There are, it should be out in the world that you should know what softwares you should learn to be a, to be whatever. For graphic design, the typical ones are Illustrator and Photoshop, but it will change from the projects and the platforms you get into.
Absolutely.
Like you would want to start coding now if you have, is there schools right now? There are many schools who started coding. Primary schools have coding actually. If you want to edit a movie, you can't go and do it in Photoshop. You have to take a film based software.
There's a very interesting one for publication, which is InDesign. So I think there are newer versions of each that are coming out. So I think it's all up there on any website, you know, as to typically what you can use to generate what. I think what the people asking questions need to know is that every version has an upgraded newer version, you know, and that needs to be utilized to get the best out of what a current design might demand from it.
Okay. How is social media? Nikita is asking, how does social media continuously upgrading technology affect a graphic designer? You know, right now it's very interesting the fact that also I just also want to say this, that many of us are not like the regular faculties. We are continuously working as designers. So it's not that we have, because we have this many experience and we are from a different generation, we are not in social media. We all of us, so right now we are, I'm handling few Instagram posts for different types of clientele that we have. So it's adaptability purely. And social media is something that a graphic designer can adapt to very easily, because it's purely communication. So it's just another media to communicate. So I don't think it has any upgrading effect, like you need to upgrade. It comes very automatically. It comes like, it's like a growth that you do. It's anything that is there out there, you adapt, and that is where collaterals come, you know. You're saying collaterals in whichever medias that we can put out to.
Absolutely.
So I don't think it's about upgrading technology, because you do it intentionally, but it comes naturally.
I think it's the current popularly used platform, because it reaches out to a larger mass. In our times that was the newspaper. And who reads the newspaper today anyways? So in that context, I think if you have to reach out to a younger audience,
yeah,
as against a newspaper which might fail terribly,
yeah,
the social media is really working most effectively. People right up to the age of 60 are constantly, you know, at it and
expressing
and hence being receiving also, you know, so much,
yeah,
that happens via social media.
Yeah.
And I think hence that has been considered an effective media.
Yeah.
As far as the technicality is concerned, I think you need to understand how print works with reference to sizes,
yeah,
and systems,
yeah,
as against maybe the sizes, yeah, and the pixels of a more digitalized
yeah,
a platform.
Yeah. Well, there's a question coming up. I don't know who's writing this. After working in industrial design industry, how can I approach to master's degree in graphics? So it's basically the ones who are experienced, done their graduation, now wants to do master's in graphic design.
Done
their graduation.
In something else.
In something else, now wants to do master's in graphic design.
So just to give you a fact, I think every class in graphic design that we've had in the last 8-10 years here at MIT have all been to do with non-graphic designers coming,
absolutely,
in for graphic,
yeah,
design,
mm,
and they have done phenomenally well.
Mm.
So I think the whole thing is about being able to really, you know, sort of put yourself to task and take up the whole challenge of how you will take on the onus of the learning. Sort of space,
mm,
you know, and I believe that there is a lot more that a master student not coming from a design background might need to do in terms of self-learning.
Yeah.
So it is the responsibility of faculty to possibly show them those cues or directions of what all they need to do beyond just the typical, you know, classroom project. Or then, if a certain student is really doing well in one area of the work, say typography or illustration, how to kind of put him on to getting
better
or furthering that in some way. But I think by and large, the fact that, you know, creativity is not the prerogative of people who've gone through a trained program. I don't know why I must say that in spite of being from academics and believing in academics in a huge way, but I know that there's a lot of learning to be done and had from outside classrooms.
Yeah.
And that is from where these young students who are not from a design background have picked up so much.
Yeah.
And I think it is, they're rich and ripe to, they're ripe to come in for a program with us, and they deserve that
chance. There's also a lot of unlearning. You think there's a lot of unlearning that they need to?
Yes, but I think that has been slightly overrated.
Mm.
You know, I mean, the first thing that any design student wants to tell the master's student is, okay, first I will tell you how to unlearn. Or then school is terrible, so you come to design school and first we'll help you to unlearn and then give you what our gyan per se is. So yes, there is one part of unlearning in terms of picking them up from a certain path that they've been following onto our path. So, if you want to say that they need to unlearn that, I don't believe that. I believe any learning is going to be productive towards the overall learning.
Okay. Okay.
But they need to understand what to grasp and what to really take from there and what to leave behind, you know. But yes, in terms of, has a learning system made you rigid?
Yeah, that's what I think.
If that is what it means,
mm,
then yes,
mm,
no system or no circumstance in any part of your time within the college or beyond it should make you rigid to things.
Yeah.
I think design grows and kind of, you know, sort of blooms,
mm,
if it is shared.
Yeah. Parth has this very interesting question. Is studying graphic design online a good idea? Considering, you know, everything you can now do online, there is a lot of material online, you can get into smaller courses, which says that you can be a graphic designer.
I don't know if I may be right to say this. I'm possibly biased when I say that I believe the best part of my life as a faculty has been those lovely relationships that I have generated with my students, or the rapport that I share with them. And I believe that the rapport does help to generate better outputs. So a student could be sitting in his own little zone, even within the classroom, and I know that the student who shares or discusses or kind of, you know, is part of that learning interactive environment possibly learns better. So yes, digital or through books or the library, they're all lovely spaces to gather extended learning.
Yeah.
But I do believe a focused sharing between a mentor and a
the human aspect of it.
Yes.
Human aspect of it. Okay. Swar has a question. Which are the kind of companies that hire graphic designers? Okay. You want me to? I can answer that.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
The kind of companies that typically, so what's happening in the campus right now, we have one of the biggest employers in the country where we have Infosys and all the bigger companies like SAP, Deloitte, all these guys coming into our campus and, you know, interviewing our students. So those are general companies that come in, but we also counsel our students on based on their strength to go and reach out to design agencies where they want to work in that kind of, you know, line.
Absolutely.
So it's both ways.
Yeah.
The employers come in, we also look out. Mm-hmm. And we, I think, I must say this with a lot of pride, that graphic design department as a department is one of the department which has, I don't think, has any time any problem with.
I think we are spoiled for choice sometimes.
We are many times spoiled.
But
yeah.
Just to answer Swar's question a little more concretely.
Hmm.
So initially, earlier, we thought that most design students should go to design agencies.
Yeah.
But today it's not like that. There is the design agency, there's the advertising agency, because we talked about applied art being a very close sort of allied area of graphic design.
Yeah.
And accepted to certain commonalities.
Absolutely.
There's also the design corporate. You know, so going into the corporate world, which possibly has its own design studios,
yeah,
as have mushroomed today,
yeah,
and they having their own little set of designers where students would prefer to go if they want to work on just one brand and its
yeah.
so many byproducts, you know.
Mm.
So there is the IT space, like
yeah,
you rightly
IT
said,
space.
There is the design agencies, there is
mm.
the advertising agencies,
mm.
and there is then this, you know, the typical corporates that
mm.
have their own design units or design studios.
Mm.
I think besides that, a lot of students have also started
yeah.
generating their own little studios.
Own studios.
And I think that's something that we have liked to encourage.
Mm.
And typically it starts off almost in the third year when they always almost envision, you know,
yeah.
heading
yeah.
a little unit and doing varied kind of products,
mm.
Projects. But I do know recently more and more students are not just working typically for one design agency,
mm.
but are also simultaneously taking up freelancing projects of their own to work at
yeah.
from home or their own studios.
Yeah.
So I think, like we just said earlier,
mm.
they're actually spoiled for
choices.
You know, choices. There's lots going on in communication design, in visual design. And I think they need to make use of all the opportunities that come their way in a way to build their portfolios, in a way, in a way to generate more sort of volumes of effective work
yeah.
and solutions.
Yeah. Meet as a question is one of the courses that we have. What is the role of graphic designer in UI UX today? UI UX is one of the biggest, is kind of one of the trending things that we are happening right now. And one of the biggest spaces where almost all people want to get into, because it has a lot of substantial exposure to things out in the world. And it also pays well, is what is being seen right now. So I think we have, like, it's been taught as courses in different levels of our semester.
Mm-hmm.
So that I think by itself is an answer where we train them to be a UI UX designer, and we also have separate departments where they can also interact. So it's well, how do you say it? It's how the graphic designer is being built right now. Is that how we want to say it?
Yeah. See, I, if you're talking about the user experience in terms of say the research and the user sort of
experience
aspects that need to be addressed.
Yeah.
The other side being the interface, which at the end of the day, if not a print surface, is a digital surface, you know.
Yeah.
The first part essentially is where possibly the focus could be more on research, and hence it doesn't need to come from just a typical designer, but from so many kinds of researchers, you know, mm-hmm. whether they are anthropologists or say ethnographers and so many different kind, you know.
Yeah.
So this is not really again the prerogative of just a designer, the UX part. But as far as the UI area is concerned, I have seen graphic designers doing well because they understand visual language, they understand details of a typography. If they have to put on a logo for a website, they know how to play with the branding experience as well as craft a para of script or textual content with more detail and finesse than somebody who has possibly not learnt it. So I have seen graphic designers do fairly well when craft the visual output for the user interface. The course that we have in, sort of introduced in graphic design does take care of the initial UX the research aspect too. And I think in some ways we are in tune with it because we understand. We can see how it needs to be sort of applied to the output. However, maybe it is a lot more serious than just, you know, a brief that needs to be generated from a small bit of research. There's more that goes into it. And I think I'd let the value be added there by the UX specialist.
Yeah. I remember UI UX now, I think it's now turning into different nomenclatures every decade. When in around 1994, it used to be multimedia. It is called as multimedia artists, multimedia. Then it was website designer. And
web designer.
Web designer. And now it has changed into UI, user interface, UX, which is user experience designer. So I think it will keep evolving. I don't know what terminology and nomenclature will come later. It could be now, nowadays we have service designers, we have experience designers. So those are the things that is continuously happening. And that's why we're saying adaptive. So today it's called UI, UX, tomorrow it's going to be called CX, computer, whatever, customer experience designer, service experience designer. So it's all changes. Dhwani has a question. What is the best way to get updated about the latest trends of graphic design industry and how to build a good portfolio? We should have addressed this the first. This should be the first question.
Well, I think learning, like I said earlier, doesn't really happen just in classrooms. So you need to expose yourself to all the varied platforms that are around you. Some of the best spaces are design conferences and design events that happen. There's one happening in almost every metro city today, you know, from Pune across to Delhi. So I think that is a good area to sort of, you know, observe and learn from. Also gives you a good opportunity and scope to interact with others than just those that are in the classroom. Like I said earlier, you know, this we actually like our students to move out of this typical academic bubble to do their learning from, you know. So if they can move out into all these various spaces and learn and grasp from, they are going to give you so much more and enrich you per se, you know, in that way. So I guess, they need to move out, and these are all the platforms, and there are so many available.
Okay. I think we have reached the end of this webinar. Thank you, Ranjana.
Thank you so much.
And thank you, people, for seeing this through. Thank you.
I make the world graphical.
I add value through my products.
I am an animator.
I am a filmmaker.
I develop trends.
I transform designs to reality.
I create environments.
I translate stories to furniture.
I design experiences.
I'm an immersive media designer.
I design mobility.
This is not only a design institute.
This is a design lab.